and you're listening to 91.7 FM, KOP, Hornsby, Austin. Up next, past People United guest Robin Rather crosses over to Thorne's show, and she's brought along her father, Dan. Rather and Rather on Rag Radio.
I'm Thorne Dreyer, and this is Rag Radio, and we have something very special for you today. It's a great honor, and it's going to be a lot of fun. We've got Dan Rather and Robin Rather in their first ever father-daughter interview. First, a little business. Rag Radio comes your way every Friday afternoon from 2 to 3 p.m. on Co-op in Austin. Co-op is a cooperatively run, all-volunteer radio station, community radio station. We are also rebroadcast on WFTE in Mount Cobb and Scranton, Pennsylvania on Sunday mornings, and by KPFT on their HD3 channel on Wednesday afternoons. All of our shows are streamed live on all three stations and are then posted as podcasts at the Internet Archive. Tracy Schultz is my engineer and co-conspirator. Tracy, how are you doing?
Doing well, thank you.
Great, cool. Today's show is being filmed by Alan Pogue. Roger Baker is here taking pictures, and everything's cool. Legendary newsman Dan Rather is the managing editor and anchor of Dan Rather Reports on HDNet. Rather went to work for CBS News in 1962, and was anchor of the CBS Evening News for 24 years, from March 9, 1981 to March 9, 2005. Rather was born in Wharton, Texas in 1931 and grew up in Houston, where he began his career as a full-time journalist with KTRH Radio and then served as news director at KHOU-TV, the CBS affiliate in Houston. He also worked with United Press International and AP and was a sportscaster. He did play-by-play for the Houston Buffs for 1 year, which we will talk about in a minute because hits home for me. Rather, who has received virtually every honor in broadcast journalism, including numerous Emmy and Peabody Awards, will join the company and the very special company of Edward R. Murrow and Walter Cronkite as a recipient of the prestigious Trustees Award of the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences, to be presented at a gala in New York City on Friday, October 18th, 2013. Rather and his wife, Jean Goebel, to whom he's been married since 1957, maintain homes in New York City and Austin, Texas. Robin Rather is an Austin-based environmental activist and sustainability consultant.
She is the CEO of Collective Strength, a market research and strategy firm where she consults on projects involving such things as renewable energy, water conservation, healthcare, and community values. She has also been a consultant on a volunteer basis for this radio station. So.
Love this radio station.
And this radio station loves you. Robin was chair of the board of the Save Our Springs Alliance, which played a very, very seminal role in environmental protections and development in this city, was co-founder of Livable City, Hill Country Conservancy, and Envision Central Texas, and serves on the advisory board of the Sustainable Food Center. Born in Houston in 1958, she is the daughter of Dan Rather and Jean Goebel. Okay, what fun. This is really great to have you guys here. Dan, it's so funny because I had thought of all kinds of things to talk about because there's so much to talk about, including I want to very soon talk about the old days in Houston because I grew up there. You were my idea of a newsman. You know, I used to watch all the news, and I also used to listen to play-by-play of the Houston Buffs. And it's interesting to me because I want to ask you in a minute whether when you did that year of play-by-play, did you go on the road? Or
no.
Did you guys do those?
No, we did recreation. First of all, it's great to be with you this afternoon.
And I have such memories of radio in Houston before I got into television, doing play-by-play sports for the University of Houston, Southwest Conference football, and the Buff baseball. But to answer your question, the Buffs had moved into AAA.
Right.
This was the year before they got into their major league franchise.
Yeah, they were only in AAA for like 1 year.
For 1 year.
They'd always been in the AA
right.
Texas League. So.
But we did not travel with the team. We didn't have the money, and I'm not sure the team particularly wanted us to travel. It was not a good team, if you recall.
Yes.
Marty Marion, the great St. Louis Cardinals shortstop, with a man named Fleshman, had bought the team. But at any rate, we did recreation, which I know is hard for people to imagine. Ronald Reagan, of all people, did the same thing back in the 1930s.
Yeah.
That when the team went, for example, to Minneapolis or St. Paul or Omaha, they were all AAA teams, a Western Union man would be at the game, and he would
type
out.
This is even more low-tech than I could have possibly feared.
This was the ultimate low-tech.
Right.
But he would give on ticker tape, which would then show up in our Houston studio. I'd be standing in front of a microphone, very much as you're standing in front of one today. The sound engineer would be in a glass-enclosed booth off to the side, and he would have a record of crowd noise. So if it were a single, I'd give you about, the telegraph would say, Fridley, Jim Fridley was the cleanup hitter, Fridley, ground ball, shortstop, BH, base hit. That's what you'd have on the
– And you
so
would say the ball is sharply hit to the right. He
that's right.
Dives for
you
the
know,
throws
you
it
know,
first.
Friendly with a sharp ground ball, deep shortstop, throw to first, not in time, base hit. And the sound engineer would play a crowd record commensurate with a single at the ballpark. Now, if it were a home run or a very close play at the plate, give him a fist, and the crowd noise would build, as you'd say, he rounds third. He's going to try for home, delting in the center is with the ball. Here's the throw, read it to the plate. Not in time. Great roar of the crowd.
Did anybody ever make a mistake and do the wrong sound effects? Or?
Oh, lots of times. And I made a lot of mistakes. I won't bore you with the whole story. But, for example, sometimes the Western Union man would be drinking an adult beverage as he was sending this game from Omaha or Minneapolis, and he would get confused. And he would put up, for example, he would say, well, Delsing walks. So I would say, ball four, and Jim Delsing takes first base. A few minutes later, when the next hitter was up, the telegraph operator would say, by the way, Delsing didn't walk. The umpire called him out on strikes. Well, thank you very much. I've got Delsing on first base. So naturally, I had the pitcher make the pickoff play, and he gets picked off.
it's so funny. I was the kid who listened to every game, you know, at night, you know, and I would. In fact, I was a reserve. When the Buffs were at home, I'd be up there with my bat every pitch, you know. And when we were, you know, in the field, I would be throwing the ball. So I was the one deceived. I had no idea.
Well, you know, Robin became a very good softball player. She was an excellent athlete. But Robin grew up when I had the Buff play-by-play. Robin was 1 year old.
I don't remember any of this. Sorry.
No, you don't remember any of it. But I always felt you were a good athlete and a good softball player, partly because your mother would turn up the radio. She would monitor my play-by-play of the Houston Buffs while nursing Robin or taking care of Robin as an infant. And the radio would be so loud that occasionally the neighbors would call over and say, Gene, I know you want to hear Dan do the game, but could you turn it down just a tad?
And you probably don't remember, Robin, when the tree fell into the house when Carla...
No, actually, I don't remember it except very vaguely. Both my mother and I have been really afraid of big rainstorms ever since then. It was just a tough night in our whole neighborhood. And one of the things I was going to say that's strange about having a journalist father, there are lots of great things, but one of the strange things is when the really bad things happen, they're not there.
They're not there.
So you learn really early to be extremely independent. And I do want to give a shout out to my mom, who's also in town. But we always say she's the best of the Rathers. And she has an almost unbelievable amount of common sense, because my father was out doing things like standing in the hurricane, you know, so he could feel how much rain there was and then report on that.
But he did not tie himself to the tree, and we're thankful for that. I want to talk about Carla in a minute, because I think that that's, not only is it I mean, it was a significant news event, but I think it tells a lot about you, Dan, as a newsman and your approach, and certainly as a, I mean, the whole thing about the radar and the way that got developed. And of course, it was when CBS discovered you, as it were, and then you went. So we'll talk about that in a minute. First, I want to talk about something that you can both be involved in, and all the way through. You know, I want both of you to talk at any time, no matter what we're talking about. And there's a lot of things to talk about. I want to talk about Austin and the environment and what's happening now with the incredible growth, and how that, as an environmentalist, how you see the possibilities of actually Austin surviving that is as something like Austin used to be. I want to talk about the corporate control of media, and what it means to be a newsman now, you know, as opposed to the old days when in Houston we had three newspapers and it was kind of like, it wasn't exactly like front page, but
it was close.
Newspaper men actually wore those fedoras and had, you know, things in their hat that said press and stuff. So, but first I want to start with something general and that Robin suggested actually as a general topic, and I think it's fascinating. Robin Rather has a sociology degree and did her honors thesis on utopian societies. Mm-hmm. And she told me that Dan Rather once called her the single most idealistic person that he had ever known. She said this was not necessarily a compliment. interesting, it would be interesting to know, because to be a journalist and to be a serious journalist, you have to be practical and pragmatic, but you also have to be something of an idealist, I would think, in order to keep doing it, to keep butting up. What's your feeling looking back now on, and both of you, on that question of idealism?
Well, idealism in some ways I think has gone a little out of fashion lately, because it's so easy to be cynical.
As have utopian societies. But, go ahead, yeah.
That's true.
Snarky is it.
But journalists are trained to be skeptical but not cynical. There's a great difference between skepticism and cynicism. But today, there's so much cynicism. Cynicism is kind of run amok. Idealism has gone out of fashion. I do agree with you that not everybody, but most people who get into journalism get into it for a certain amount of idealism, being idealistic. You want to belong, you want to be part of something bigger than yourself. You want to be part of something that matters. You want to be part of something that's important. You want to contribute. And that leads to an idealistic view of life. And I plead guilty to being an idealist. Robin has taught me a great deal about keeping idealism alive and how you can't let idealism let the flame go out. But it is true that journalism is filled with idealistic people. Those who don't like what they do sometimes think, well, they're too idealistic, and it leads to what these critics say is bias or what have you. But no doubt that is an important part of journalism. But more importantly, I think idealism and being idealistic is central to being an American. That we were founded by forward-looking, optimistic, idealistic people. And it's very much in the American character to be idealistic. The whole idea of we're frontier people. We're constantly moving forward. Yes, there's great danger out there. Who thinks you can civilize this western part of this continent? Well, we did. We're still a frontier-minded people going into cosmos, our search into the even deep probes into our cosmos and beyond is built on idealism. I think it's an essential part of being an American to be idealistic. Now, it is true that I said of Robin, because I believe it myself.
You
she's the most idealistic person I have ever met. That if Robin's walking along the street and someone puts a pistol in her ribs and says, give you your money, the first thing in Robin's mind is, I wonder what caused this person to reach this point in their life, and what can I do to turn this person around? With the gun in your ribs, the answer is not much, but Robin's a true believer, there must be something.
Robin, you've been involved in, well, you were involved with Save Our Springs, which was certainly a very idealistic kind of, but you were also involved in some very pragmatic decisions involving that and involving, to be effective, you know, we have to temper maybe our idealism with some kind of pragmatism. When you look back on it, what do you think in terms of that, what you studied and then what you've been able to put into practice in your life?
A couple things. First of all, I get up almost every day and in my own fashion pray that I don't become bitter, cynical, or exhausted. And a lot of days that's hard. I think even living in an almost idyllic place like Austin has been, for me at least, even here, I think it's hard to keep your idealism going. And I think it's particularly hard right now. Dad talked about idealism being part of the American DNA, if you will. I think this is the hardest time there maybe it's ever been to be an idealistic American. And I'm going to say this regretfully, but I think in the Obama administration, because we all had so many hopes for him, or many of us did, that it's been very difficult to keep idealism about the country going when, you know, we've been in multiple wars, we've had some really tough constitutional rollbacks, we've had Citizens United, and, you know, the role of money in every industry and every aspect of government. I think this is the most challenging time there's ever been, at least in my more than five decades, to stay idealistic. I agree with that. I think it's very important. And one of the reasons I like having these kinds of conversations as a community, how we deal to, it's out of fashion, but it's also just very difficult to see where's the way forward. And that's what I think is interesting. And I think that's the link between journalism and environmentalism is, okay, things are tough. Where do we go from here? Who's got a good plan? Who's got the vision? How do you start to visualize that?
Okay, Robin, you and I have something in common, although the actual experience is very different, in that we were both, I think, what they used to call journalism brats. You know, my father was a newspaper man, worked for the Houston Chronicle, was a reporter and editor, and also was a short story writer, was published in a bunch of international publications and stuff. He was a very interesting personality, and also I worked with Dan, I guess, at the Houston Chronicle, at least, for one thing, for the year that you worked at the Chronicle.
That's true. He was a star at the Houston Chronicle. He was a big byline regular with the newspaper. I was trying to catch on, and partly because I was and remain a terrible speller. I didn't make my tryout at the Chronicle. They took one look at my atrocious spelling and said, you might have a future in radio. And because the newspaper owned a radio station, they sent me over to the radio station. That's how I came to work at KTRH.
Right.
But the Chronicle was... It was not only a very influential newspaper in Houston, but it was an influential newspaper in the state. The Jesse Jones interest, Jesse H. Jones, who was part of the Roosevelt cabinet for a while, one of the saviors of the country.
Part of the good old boy network that ran Houston, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And a good old boy network indeed ran it. Some would argue how good the good old boys were, in fact. But one thing, they all had tons of money.
Yes.
None more than the Jones interest. And the Jones family, which has since become one of the more philanthropic families in Texas, and that's saying a lot, but they owned the Chronicle, and the Chronicle was a very influential newspaper on a state basis. It was a very stable place to work, hard for many people in the newspaper business today. Your father had been there, I think, for some time since the early 1940s.
Yes.
When I got there in the mid-50s, he was well-established, as I say, a big byline reporter.
It's another person, by the way, who worked for a short period of time at the Chronicle while my father did. It was Molly Ivins, and I remember my father talking about this kind of free spirit who was working. You know, who was, I think she was an intern, and he said she goes around barefoot in the city room. He thought that was very cool.
He thought that was very cool, but let me tell you that the Chronicle was not very kind to free spirits.
Yes.
Your father excluded, but the superstructure of the newspaper was very conservative, and going without a tie, never mind going without your shoes,
yes.
was frowned upon.
Yes, yes. I'm sure it didn't last very long in her. So there were three newspapers in Houston then, the Houston Chronicle, the Houston Post, and the Houston Press, the Press being a Scripps Howard newspaper, the other two being Houston-owned. The Hobby family owned the Post. Hobby being another good old boy family, and Bill Hobby was lieutenant governor of the state. For a substantial period of time. It's a whole different era. You know, it was just such an incredibly different era. You know, you had your three network television stations. You had news. I mean, it was a. I wouldn't say it was a golden era of journalism. I mean, it was. There were lots and lots of problems, but it certainly was different. So things certainly have changed.
The biggest thing was that, in terms of newspapers, first of all, there were three separate newspapers. They were independent newspapers. As you mentioned, the Post and the Chronicle were owned by people in Houston. The Hobbies owned the Post, and the Jones Interest owned the Chronicle. Scripps Howard, outside, they were the only, if you will, outside ownership. But the point here is there was real competition in the papers. And while both the Post and the Chronicle had their sacred cows, which is to say big people in the community about whom no bad things would be written, the Post was sort of kept the balance. There was competition, and you had the locally owned papers and locally owned radio stations. I think at this time, we're talking in the period late 1950s into the early 1960s, there were no fewer than a half a dozen, and I'd want to say 9 or 10, locally owned radio stations. Now, compare that with today, in which
most of them are owned by Clear Channel or one or
I
two.
I thought they all were, except for
well,
this
exactly.
One.
And yeah. You've had one merger after another, one purchase of getting ever bigger in both radio, television, and for that matter with newspapers, and till we've reached the point where something more than 80% of the true national distribution of news is owned by no more than six conglomerate, very large corporations. My count is four, but some people say six, so let's say six. It's light years of difference. And so when people say, well, okay, that's the case for what difference it makes, here's the difference that it makes. That I'm pausing because I want to clean up my language, but...
That's okay, Dad.
No, very big media is in bed with very big government, whether that government is run at any particular time in Washington by Democrats or Republicans. And this does not serve the public interest when it comes to news. And that's the difference between today and the era we're talking about, late 50s, early 60s.
Okay, I'm Thorne Dreyer. This is Rag Radio. My guests are Dan Rather, newsman, and Robin Rather, environmental activist, in their first father-daughter interview ever. We'll be right back. I'm Thorne Dreyer. This is Rag Radio. Tracy Schultz, what were we just listening to there?
That was What Is the Frequency, Kenneth, done by R.E.M. It's like a song that's been legendarily linked to our guest, Mr. Dan Rather.
And I believe you danced to that song on... there's a long story. I don't know if we want to really go into that whole
Please
thing.
Please don't look that up on YouTube, yeah. Really. So Letterman, Dad with R.E.M. on Letterman, singing that Wonderful song and song. Actually dancing.
Yeah.
Well, R.E.M. recorded the song, and it had to do with an unfortunate incident that happened to me. And when they came to rehearse for a program in New York City, that I came and sang along with them for about three or four bars until they realized I could not carry a tune in a bucket with a lid on it and asked me to dance instead of sing.
So you, when we say that you sang in three or four bars, we weren't talking about several bars up and down the street.
No.
Okay.
Unfortunate.
Okay. Your grandmother told you that a hurricane would get you very close to God, I think, something to that effect.
Well, my grandmother Paige, who was my maternal grandmother down in Bloomington, Texas, taught me, first of all, Danny, you should fear only God and hurricanes.
God and hurricanes. Okay.
And then she said, it would be very difficult, if not impossible, to get closer to God than you are when you're in the middle of a hurricane.
Okay, we mentioned Carla a few minutes ago, and I remember Carla very well. I was in Houston, and I remember going out walking in the street. I mean, it was a heavy-duty hurricane that hit just south of Galveston, I guess.
That's right. The year was 1961, September 1961. It was at the time, and I think still is, in terms of geographical size, the largest hurricane on record in the Gulf of Mexico, and at one time it had winds gusting 200 miles an hour and above.
I think the story of how you covered Carla, how it came about, how you sold your news director on doing it, you sold him on getting there early because you knew that the island was going to be closed off and other reporters wouldn't be able to get there, and what happened with your innovation with radar, which was a new thing, I guess, or was a Galveston was where the Weather Bureau was. And in fact, I mentioned, I don't guess we mentioned it, my father worked as moonlighted when he was working at the Chronicle as a weatherman, sort of. I mean, they didn't really have weathermen. This was before even Ed Brandon. My father would, after he got off work at the Chronicle, he and his photographer, because my father didn't drive, would, you know, get in the car and go to Galveston, check at the Weather Bureau, call back in to KTRH News and give a weather report. So that was so everything was new. It was a time of incredible
transition.
Well,
that's the point, that technology, speaking of technology, overcoming us and helping us time after time, the radar was developed during World War II. It was not being used for weather forecasting. No radio or television station in the nation had radar. The Weather Service sort of belatedly started using radar, experimenting with it to predict weather patterns. And particularly they put it in Galveston because it's an island and faces the Gulf of Mexico, saying to themselves, maybe it can be useful particularly with hurricanes. So when Hurricane Carla came, this huge hurricane, largest geographical size on record, particularly fierce hurricane, naturally, I said, this could be a real story. It didn't take much.
You actually plotted the course in your
Well, I had done that as kind of a hobby since I was a child. Any time a hurricane was coming in our direction.
See, my hobby was listening to Houston Buff games, but that's, I guess.
But to make a long story somewhat short, and it's a longer story, right, which I have written about, convinced, I had just come into television and convinced the people who owned the station. They were from Boston and Pittsburgh. They didn't know anything about hurricanes. And I said, this could be a historic hurricane, and we should go to Galveston because Galveston has this new radar. And I explained to them that the radar had the potential to spot the hurricane for that. Anyway, we went to Galveston knowing that as the hurricane got closer, the island would be cut off. The island was cut off. I made arrangements with the Weather Bureau to give me a look at the radar, and it really knocked my eyes back because you could see this monster hurricane for the first time, see an image. Before that, people had to make do with their imaginations. Here the radar had. So the idea came up to give people an idea of its size and strength, let's put a scale map of Texas, superimpose that on transparent plastic over the radar, and it will show you how huge and dangerous this is. The Weather Bureau was reluctant to let us, once I saw it, I said, boy, that would be something for the audience to see. The Weather Bureau was reluctant because they feared it might panic people. Eventually, they became convinced it would be a public service because it might convince people, yes, you need to get out of lowlands. And so we put it on the air, and it made such an impact that other television stations in the state, nobody else could get on the island to do this kind of work, picked up our coverage, and the national news began to pick up the coverage. Yeah. And it, a result, I'm not saying it was only because of what we did with the showing a picture of the hurricane on the radar, on the television screen, but at the time it affected the largest peacetime evacuation in the history of the country.
So those were some interesting decisions you made. The other good decision you made was not to follow up on the idea of tying yourself to a tree, partly because of the snakes.
Well, it did enter our mind, and we did try it.
Which you actually did try it.
No, before the hurricane, the winds were up, the waves were up, but before it came in, the idea was, look, if we can stand outside and be outside in the hurricane, then it was, well, how are you going to stand up? And it, so we said, well, look, maybe we can tie ourselves around a tree. Maybe I can chain myself around a tree. I know it sounds crazy. It is crazy.
It is crazy.
But we, but we dismissed it very, very quickly as an impractical idea. For one thing, it had not occurred to me, but it's true, that snakes, like people, go for the high ground in hurricanes. And Galveston has a slight ridge at the top, and snakes were becoming increasingly apparent on the outside. And so this idea of chaining oneself or tying oneself to a tree was dismissed pretty quickly.
Okay, and we're thankful about that. But the story then is it. After this, it became legend because you were actually hired and you went to CBS News. I want to take a leap now. I want to talk about Austin. And Robin, I have brought the newspaper with me today because there's a lot of interesting coverage in today's Austin American Statesman. For one thing, our two big time state filibusterers are in the news, Ted Cruz and Wendy Davis,
who apparently big talk in Texans. That I don't see how that's news. That seems kind of interesting to me.
Yeah, well, you mean blowhards are us?
Sort of.
So anyway, Wendy Davis apparently is going to run for governor, and Ted Cruz is an object for many of ridicule, but for others, I guess, of adulation for his filibuster, as I would call it, because it wasn't really. But there's also a story about the city of Austin approving development on a family's ranch land it says here, the council voted 6-1 to give the Garza family permission for somewhat more extensive development than would normally be allowed under the Save Our Springs environmental rules. And this is going to be, I think, a fairly major development.
It's a total cave by the city council, and it's a rollback of the SOS ordinance that's been, you know, so hard fought for so long. And we could talk the whole rest of the hour about my thoughts on how ridiculous that is.
Well, tell us what SOS was and why it was important and how it affected.
Well, SOS is, you know, most people think of it as not just the leading environmental advocacy group in this part of the country, but one of the more popular and successful groups in the sense that, and I didn't live in Austin when the first round of SOS successes happened, but they used the citizens' petition as a way to force the council at that time to adopt stricter rules that would protect our fresh water sources. And Austin is so blessed, and one of the reasons that Austin is so magical to so many people is we have our own aquifer. We have our own people here go swimming in Barton Springs. That's our iconic, soulful touch point as a community, and it has been since all the way back to the time of the Native Americans. And so the SOS ordinance went into effect by citizens' petition, and is supposed to have been in effect for 20 years or more. But at first, it was just the legislature that would bear down on Austin and prevent it from implementing its own ordinance. But it's outrageous to me that it's not the legislature doing it. It's our own freely elected, you know, mostly green council that's doing it.
Right.
And, Dad said before that idealism is out of fashion, and I'm concerned that in Austin, real environmental protection, both of water and air, is going out of fashion, and we shouldn't let it.
Austin has this image of being this incredibly progressive city, and the city council as being this very progressive city council. And yet, Austin last year voted down an affordable housing move, and is an incredibly segregated city.
Well, I think you can call Austin progressive only by Texas standards. I think if you look around the country, we're not even in the top 50 for what I consider super progressive cities. Austin has so many strong points, so many great, talented, creative people, and it always has. But most people I talk to feel like we're losing it. And I know it's almost a cliche to say every generation of new Austinites, everyone says, oh, it was better in the 60s. Well, Austin in the 50s was better and so forth. But I feel, and I think I hear this all the time around town, a lot of people feel like around the time that F1 came to Austin is when...
That's Formula One for people who aren't in Austin.
Formula One. When that decision was made, that's when people were like, oh, we're totally losing it now. And it does seem to a lot of people that as we've grown both in population and in our economic strength, which is phenomenal and not something to take for granted, we're going to have to be even more vigilant about our clean air and clean water resources in the age of climate change than we've ever been before. And so these kind of rollbacks that you're talking about in the paper today, it's extremely dangerous and it's unfortunate. And I think our council should be ashamed of themselves. I really mean that. And I mean that even though several of them are close friends of mine and I voted for almost all of them. They're not holding the line as they should be.
I guess the larger question, and Dan, we're talking with Dan Rather and Robin Rather. Dan, in your, you and I, and because Robin told me, they said that we've always come, you know, even I lived in Houston, but Austin, we always came to Austin, came back and forth to Austin, and Austin was this, just this, it was nirvana in the hills. It was this just wonderful, wonderful place and unique. I mean, people came to Austin from wherever and they just didn't leave, especially in the mid-60s when I first came here. It was just amazing. Austin is now undergoing this incredible growth spurt. It's become a high-tech center, the probably fastest-growing tech center in the country, and on all kinds of other levels. It's just growing, and it's becoming unaffordable for the people who've really, in some ways, made it what it is, especially the musicians that the city's famous for. Is it possible? I mean, is this something even, can you, is it possible to retain at least something of a livable city with that kind of growth spurt? I mean,
absolutely. And I acknowledge, I confess, if that's the right word, I am an optimist by experience and by nature. But I'm very optimistic about Austin. One reason I am, and forgive me if you must for praising my daughter, is because Austin has so many people like Robin Rather. Idealistic, courageous, not afraid to speak up, and I sort of quarrel with the word environmentalist. Robin and I have this discussion all the time. What they're talking about is conservation, conserving clean air, clean water, clean ground. And I think there's a consensus, whether people consider themselves progressives or liberals on the one hand, or conservatives or reactionaries on the other hand, there is common ground. And I've seen Robin work when she was helping to lead Save Our Springs, SOS, that Robin is the kind of person, she walks into a room and says, look, folks, I know that you don't agree with us. There are 100 things in which we can't agree, but can we find one or two things, common ground, in which we can work? Now, this spirit has carried Austin forward through its incredible growth with still a reputation, I think a justified reputation, of being a green city, a progressive city in the sense that it's interested in conserving clean air, clean water. That's the spirit, that's the DNA of Austin. I think it's still here. Now, it's easy on a time when the city council makes a, what Robin calls a outrageous vote, to say, well, it's all gone with the wind. I don't think so. As long as people have, you know, I once referred to Robin, I used to always refer to as Robin the Lionhearted. As long as they have lion-hearted people like Robin who are willing to speak up, who are willing to try to find common ground, then I remain optimistic about Austin's future.
Well, I appreciate that, Dad. I will say that I am everything I know about the environment I learned from really fantastic environmentalists here, Susanna Almanza, Bill Bunch, Bridget Shea, Mary Arnold. There is an army of phenomenal expert environmentalists in this town, and I am just one of many. I think the thing is, though, it has to be, you have to be vigilant. Austin, I think our biggest problem is we think we're a lot greener than we are, and I think there's an aspect of resting on our laurels and taking it for granted by the elected officials who'll say, oh, yeah, we used to be a very environmental town, but now we're focused on other things. And I think the affordability issue, I'm so glad you raised that. To me, they're linked, and that Austin's either going to be the kind of place, not that musicians could live in, but that teachers and firemen and emerging journalists and lots of different kinds of people, or it's going to become sort of like Aspen, where it's really just a playground for the F1 crowd. And I know that seems far-fetched. My father was born in Houston and spends a lot of time in New York and comes to Austin as often as he can to visit us. But if you're really on the ground here, it doesn't feel even like it felt as recently as 7 or 10 years ago. And I think all I'm saying is I think we have to stay extremely vigilant and not take any votes for granted, not take any situations for granted. Stay on it.
Robin Rather told the Austin Chronicle, "The high-tech boom is not killing Austin, but our own inability to act as a united community implementing the best ideas to solve our growth problems is." That was in 2000. Oh. That was 13 years ago. Dreyer searches around and finds these things. One thing, and then we'll move on. In fact, we're going to take another break. But one one thing that's interesting is that Austin has is just now bringing in single-member districts, probably the last major city in the country to move to single-member districts in city council. Right. What kind of difference do you think that will make? Quickly, because we need to...
Well, quickly, I was one of the first environmentalists to endorse the whole so-called 10-1 single-member districts. I think it remains to be seen. I mean, we could have single-member districts that are a mess. Dallas has had... I've worked up in Dallas when their single-member district council people were literally fighting each other, physically swinging at each other on the dais during the council meetings. It can come to that. I think we're capable of having a wonderful single-member district experience. The hope is that it brings the whole practice of politics much closer to individual neighborhoods, and that's the hope, and that's what we're capable of. Let's see if that's what we do.
Okay, I'm Thorne Dreyer. This is Rag Radio. We're visiting with newsman Dan Rather and conservationist Robin Rather in their first father-daughter interview. We'll be right back.
You said before we met that your life was awful tame. Well, I took you to a nightclub and the whole band knew your name. Oh, well, baby, 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 I've got news for you. Oh, somehow your story don't ring true. Well, I've got news. Cause you took the wrong express, and then you walked in smiling with your lipstick all a mess. Oh, let me say to you, little mama, whoa, I've got news for you.
And we've got news for you with newsman Dan Rather and Robin Rather, Austin environmentalist and consultant on sustainability issues. This is a lot of fun. I'm enjoying this immensely. Jeff Daniels recently won the Best Actor Emmy for playing Will McAvoy, the anchorman on the Newsroom. And I know, Dan, that you're a big fan of the Newsroom and that you blog about it. I think you blog every episode.
I do. I've gotten very interested in the Newsroom. It has brought to screen, whether you're talking about big theater, movie theater, or television screen, the most authentic depiction of television news that's ever been in existence. I admire it for that reason. And
Aaron Sorkin is a genius, too.
Well, so Aaron Sorkin, whom I don't know, I've met him and have interviewed him, but he's masterful, as we learned with A Few Good Men, The West Wing. A long list of credits. This is the first time he's really faced a lot of criticism. He says so himself.
Yeah.
And many people have been critical of the Newsroom, but I'm not among them because I'm intrigued. I do follow the story. I think it's a very strong storyline, and it's so authentic that it intrigues me week to week. And I was so glad to see Emmy come here.
There were a lot of people who were critical of that because everybody has their own, you know, they follow their own. But I love it. I also follow it and also enjoy it a lot. And I think, as you pointed out, it is theater, right. You know, and it's not, we can't take it literally. There's a lot of stuff about it that's not going to be true.
Well, it's Aaron Sorkin's idealistic, to use that word again, idealistic view of what news in a newsroom and news directors and an anchor could be, in the same way he... Yeah. With the West Wing, it was his idealized version of what an ideal presidency would be and could be.
Right.
And in that sense, whether you follow the story or like the story or not, I think it's inspiring.
It's also a lot of fun to see Jane Fonda, as my friend says, playing Ted Turner. A little bit of irony there. But she's wonderful, and the only thing I've seen her in lately that was even more wonderful was The Butler, where she played Nancy Reagan. Right. To a T in a cameo, just wonderful. The storyline of Newsroom has been very interesting, and I just wondered if there's anything that, obviously your story was entirely different, right. But if there's anything that remind you of stuff that happened with you in CBS.
Well, of course, there are any number of things that for those who don't know the newsroom, very quickly what it is this television news operation, this big time cable news newsroom and news whole news division has gotten in trouble because it has run a story, and which it turns out their producer did some unethical things editing the videotape of an interview, and they had to retract it. Aaron Sorkin and others have indicated this is based on a CNN case of some years ago in which CNN had to completely retract the story.
Right.
Where the similarities are with my own case in CBS News and the Bush military service is that in the case of this fiction, the corporate ownership of the news division stands by and stands up for its news division and its reporters, even though they had clearly made a mistake.
Right.
And in our case, we reported a truth.
Right.
Let's not go back over. It takes too long.
I know. Yeah.
But when this, it's interesting because in Sorkin's idealistic view, the ownership, the corporate ownership, said, "Okay, yes, our newsroom made a mistake, but you know what? We're going to stick up for them and stick by them." And they stuck up for their anchorman as well.
Right.
Well, that would be similar, I guess, you know, just to go back even further, that would be more similar to during the Nixon administration, the whole are you running for something, where the CBS management did back you up to the hilt. And so it's not just idealistic. That has happened, and hopefully it happened, you know, maybe those days aren't gone, but it certainly did happen, and thankfully
that was
it did.
At a press conference when Nixon asked you if you were running for something, and you said, Mr. President, are you running for something?
Mr. President.
No, sir, Ms. Sorry.
Well, and actually, I think it was in Houston, wasn't it?
Well, it was in Houston. But Robin raises an interesting point, not to belabor this point.
Yeah.
In the 1970s, CBS News was owned and operated by CBS, Inc., which was headed by William S. Paley, who did back his news division, did back his reporters.
To the hilt.
But with the newsroom, this HBO series, what I like about it is it reminds the public that it matters who owns these major news networks and what their attitude toward community service, public service is. Bill Paley, when he was alive and ran CBS News, saw CBS News. He was interested in making money, but he saw news as a public service and a public trust. And what Sorkin is outlining in the newsroom is it would be nice if things could go back to that. We all know they aren't going back to that, but boy, wouldn't it be nice.
But it's interesting because in the newsroom, it was no given that they were going to support the news department in this. Because, I mean, the character played by Jane Fonda and her son, who was the hard character, they had been at odds with the news operation a lot. And so it wasn't just a simple, it was complex.
No, it was complex, and which made the decision for the corporate side to stick by their news division maybe even more surprising to people who follow these things.
Well, one thing I wanted to ask, just we were talking in the car coming over here about the Texas Tribune, which, of course, is an online newsroom, if you want to call it that, and it's also a nonprofit. And I wonder, Dad, if you feel that the future of news is more in that direction as a business model, does that provide, you know, greater reporter protection, greater freedom of expression, less corporate interference, and
well, the short answer is yes. And for transparency, let me say that I was among the founding people involved with the Texas Tribune, wasn't able to contribute as much as I'd hoped, but nonetheless, people should know that. But I think the answer is yes, at least in the short term. What's necessary now for news, we're in this interregnum. The old order is dead and gone. The new order is not completely in place, which is why I use a term the Roman Catholic Church sometimes use. We're in an interregnum. A new business model needs to be found, which a business model that can, on a continuing, sustained basis, support deep digging, investigative reporting, first-class international reporting, all of which require a lot of money. Nobody's come up with a business model that will do that. In the interim, nonprofits like the Texas Tribune, like for that matter co-op radio, are filling a very important void for the public. I don't think it's the long-range solution, but in this interregnum period, it's absolutely essential, especially for investigative reporting and first-class foreign news.
Do you know Bob McChesney of Free Press? But one of the things that he believes is that, and he's looking, you know, he's among others looking for that new model. He thinks that it has to involve public support. Do you think public funding? Do you think that?
I do. For example, I wonder, you know, we all treasure, or at least I treasure, I think most people treasure, National Public Radio. Why we can't have a companion, National Public Television? It is true we have public television, but as you know, it's more balkanized. It's not one centrally operated true national thing. Why can't we have a public, national public television that's comparable with National Public Radio? I think it's possible. To answer your question, yes, I think public funding can provide a lot, but having spent all of my career in commercial radio and television, to sustain the kind of vigorous investigative reporting and first-class journalism, we need to find a way that it pays for itself.
To monetize it.
To produce a profit.
But there are, I mean, the Texas Tribune, I think, is a fairly remarkable, it's very significant what they've done. You've got a lot of other models, Huffington Post, for instance, where most of the people that write for the Huffington Post don't make anything, aren't paid anything. The whole question is, and this is true with the internet, with so many different areas, it's true in music. It's broken things down, it's compartmentalized things, and there's no new models that have come up. You know, in the old days, it wasn't hard to get an audience. You know, you had three television networks, you know, and everybody watched them. And now it's like you have to fight for an audience.
Such an important point. The fragmentation of the audience into smaller and smaller entities has made it all the more difficult to get some cooperative, if it need be, or some commercial operation that can command a large enough audience in the fierce competitive pit that is what I think we have, 850 television places on my tablet
right.
or something like that. The fragmentation of the audience makes it ever increasingly more difficult to come up with a business model that will produce the kind of profits, spin off the kind of revenue that can finance sustained first-class reporting.
Right.
But being the optimist that I am, we'll find that business model. I'm disappointed we haven't found it already.
Well, I just want to jump in and say I think there are two other parts of the equation besides the business model. One of them is, and I want to get back to sort of national leadership, I think we're really missing who is that person that has such a powerful vision. I think the biggest issue we have as a country, you know, crappy news, forgive my technical terminology, is one problem. But I think the much bigger problem is we don't have one or more national figures that can unify us around a central direction going forward. And until we have someone or multiple people who can genuinely do that, again, a lot of people thought Obama would be that guy. It turned out he wasn't. I think it's difficult for communication vehicles to unify up if you don't have leaders that are unifying us up. And that's not to say we don't have mayors and elected officials here and there, but in general, we just don't have that powerful voice that brings us together and automatically creates an audience that wants to hear something and discuss it, you know, honestly and not in a partisan way. If we could ever get to that point, I think it would make it a lot easier to get these business models rolling.
I don't want to be the pessimist in the face, especially, you know, sitting opposite the optimist here. But I mean, and I certainly agree with you about Obama not being the inspiring leader, but we're also facing with gerrymandering and Citizens United, with the role of corporate money in politics, and with the sort of the rise of anti-intellectualism and anti-factism, and the incredible right wing. Could one person make a difference at this point?
Well, I think one person can make a difference, and it occurs to me, Robin was talking. For example, in journalism, Ted Turner was a visionary.
Yes.
And what we're looking for in journalism now is another Ted Turner, or several Ted Turners. People who have a vision. Turner was laughed at when he had the idea of CNN. And in the very early years, all kinds of people in network television predicted its rapid demise. Now, I'm not holding Ted Turner out as the be-all and end-all, but let's face it, he was a visionary, he affected his vision, and we could use a lot of that in journalism. Now, for the nation as a whole, we could spend the rest of the afternoon talking about it, but we do have to recognize what is a fact. He said, we're getting kind of bad about not wanting to face the facts. As of this moment, the very large corporations and their money, not exclusively, there's union money involved, but very big money has virtually bought the government. And how we get it back from sheer money interest alone is, I think, the major challenge of our American time.
And what is the path forward? I guess is part of that path forward having some visionaries in leadership?
Well, actually, can I riff on your question?
2 minutes, yeah.
I wanted to ask Dad, back in the day, activists like Martin Luther King were able to bring to bear some of this, what we're talking about. Are we past the point where activism, no matter who the leadership is, can affect change? Has money got such a solid grip on it that we can't get past it with straight-up activism, grassroots activism? In the era of drones and the corporate control of government, can we get past that, do you think?
We can get past that, and the short answer is no. It's not a case of all is lost. Having covered Dr. Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, and others who had a dream, hearts can inspire other hearts with their fire. And what we need, yes, it would be nice to have leaders such as some of the ones I've mentioned, but in answer to the earlier, not all is lost because we, the people, put it all in caps, W, T, and P. We, the people, still have, when we choose to use it, we have the winning hand. Whether we can muster the will and whether we can put our own hearts on fire and thus inspire others is the question of the day.
Right. Wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
This has been great. Dan Rather is anchor and managing editor of Dan Rather Reports. And Robin Rather is CEO of Collective Strength and has been a force in the Austin sort of environmental and conservation movements for a long time. I want to thank everybody. Thank you, Tracy Schultz. I'm Thorne Dreyer. Dan Rather, would you sign off for us?
Courage.
There you go.
Rag, mama, rag, I can't believe it's true. Rag, mama, rag, what did you do?